Ladies and gentlemen, this is episode 16 of Xclude with Xclude. My guest today is Madeline Barlow. She is a fellow party goer here in the Philadelphia scene, as well as, more importantly, she has a PhD in psychology and is very helpful when it comes to anything mentally challenging, whether it be stress in the job or stress in sports or anything of that sort of nature. Madeline is here to definitely cover all you need. I'm going to go more into depth with that subject matter as well as everything else under the sun here in this episode. But Madeline, hey, thank you so much for being around.
Hi, Eric. Thank you for having me.
No problem. But how was your weekend?
It was a good weekend. Spent the weekend going to see some live music with my boyfriend, mm-hmm. Eric, as well. So we've got two Erics. Mm-hmm. And so it was a great time just getting to experiencing some time with my friends and with the music and everything.
Gotcha.
Yeah,
awesome.
What about yours? How was
Mine was fantastic. I've had, great. Like, normally with Valentine's Day, I just, fucking ignore it. I just go in my bedroom, eat some pizza, and play games, I guess. Or ride my bike, whatever. This Valentine's Day was different because I had somebody in mind who I wanted to go out with, and she happily accepted, and we ran around town, went to Woody's, went to the Philly Car Show, and spent a lot of time together.
Awesome.
So definitely awesome. And everything went smooth. The reservation to the restaurant I went to, it's called Rouge or Rogue. Oh.
Love
in Brenhouse Square.
Love it.
Yes.
One
okay.
of my favorite places.
Yeah. Very yes. intimate setting.
Yes.
Yes.
I call it a sexy library.
Yes.
It really looks like one, doesn't it?
Agreed. small intimate setting. I think I had what did I have? I think I had this pasta, or she had this pasta that was awesome. I just wanted to go back there because normally during the summer you would see people out. They have down-out seating mm-hmm. to where you're, like,
right.
super close to Warehouse Square. And every time I ride my bike along that area, I would always see, like, or at least in my head, the kind of, like, the upper class of Philadelphia mm-hmm. and just dine and lounge and relax and be part of, you know, this kind of, like, organic, like, crust of, like, what I've kind of, like, wanted to be. I guess to a
sure.
degree, and just like I've always seen that, I was like, man, I want to go to that place. It's that kind of in crowd, and I finally did.
Awesome.
And I got reservations for it, and yeah, had a great time. As
did
well
you
as
have
all
any
the other
wine?
Things.
Their wine's fantastic.
I didn't have any wine. I had the cocktails okay. with okay. wine. I need to get more accustomed to.
Sure. Yeah.
I can get into some white wines here and there,
mm-hmm.
But not so much reds. I feel that's more of a required kind
it
of
is.
Taste. And I feel like I need to try a sampler or a range of different kinds of wines just to get my palate more widened in that sense.
Absolutely.
To where I feel comfortable with that kind of stuff, because I don't want to spend money on like a bottle and I don't know what I'm getting. So,
oh, yeah, for
yeah.
sure. It is acquired taste. So take some time, play with it a little
yeah.
bit, see what you think about it.
Is there any wineries around here by chance? I would imagine maybe there's some. I know there's some breweries for sure.
Out in Bucks County, which is actually where I'm from.
Gotcha.
There's a couple. So out more so you get towards the country-esque
okay.
areas, and you'll get a couple wineries. Yeah.
Okay. Gotcha. Did you grow up around that area, Bucks? Or
mm-hmm.
Okay. Gotcha.
Yeah.
Describe your upbringing there.
Yeah. So my parents actually still live in the same house I grew up in Yardley, Pennsylvania. So I went to elementary through high school out there, and I would say it was a really wonderful time. My upbringing was really wonderful. You know, I'm an only child, so that's something that's interesting about me. And, you know, my mom and my dad lived with my mom's mom at certain points, eventually had a dog. Kids dream to have a dog,
yes.
usually. So ended up getting a dog at one point. And then the majority of my time as a kid was spent swimming. So that was a big part of my life, swimming from, I mean, really, I started swimming when I was one, I would say.
So a bit of a water baby, maybe
yes,
by chance?
I feel that is true. You know, I coached at the same pool I swam at recently. A few years ago, I was still coaching at that same pool, and it just holds so many memories from the time I was one until... Yeah, until a couple years ago, even.
How did you get into swimming? Was it natural to you? Did your parents push you into it? How did you get into it?
They did not push me, which is wonderful. It's one thing working in sports now, you know, you do see that a lot. So how it happened, I love this story, actually. When I was about 8, I went to our high school for a swim lesson sign up and did what they had asked me to do. I do remember I wasn't able to do the butterfly arms, but I could at least get the butterfly kick. But everything else was really natural. And then later that night or the next day, I don't remember, my mom came to me and said, you know, I just got a phone call from the swim coach and he asked if you'd like to be on the swim team because he really thinks you'd be a great swimmer. Mm-hmm. So I said yes. And it started from there. And I have really fond memories of that swim coach, but it was truly because he reached out.
Now, I would assume that from there, once the coach reached out and time passed, that you started to compete?
Yes. I mean, I'm pretty sure I started competing within a couple months, I would say. Yeah. So started at our, I believe it was Suburban Aquatic League, so SAL, S-A-L. Okay. And we started with weekend meets, so usually Saturday meets. Sure. Yeah. So practicing a couple days a week, might have been 5 days a week when I was younger. Not totally sure. Feels like a lot anyways. And yeah, with one meet a week, I started when I was about 8.
Mm-hmm. Awesome. I would like to think at that point you were kind of like finding, forgive me, I don't know too much about swimming.
That's okay.
But you were finding your specific kind of discipline and or style just mm-hmm. as well.
Yeah. And I do feel like that changed over time. However, as I had said, I made a point to say that I wasn't able to do the butterfly arms. Right. Well, ironically enough, I became a butterflyer. Hey. So there we go. But it took a little bit of time, but I naturally became more of a backstroker and a butterflyer. And those just were things that felt truly, truly natural. I was really aligned with that type of swimming, and it was just fun. I loved to swim.
Now, from there, do you consider, from where you're at now, do you consider swimming a lifestyle just as much as, let's say, cycling can potentially be, or let's say, DJing can potentially be, or any kind of hobby that kind of blends into, like, your lifestyle to a point where it's, like, seamless, or to a point where you've done it long enough that some aspects of that, whatever hobby or discipline or sport, kind of resonate with you?
Sure. Yeah, I mean, I think anything, like you just said, anything can become a lifestyle or a part of your life. For me, swimming was my life for many, many years. And it is what led me to be doing what I'm doing now, which we'll get to in a mm-hmm. little bit. But it was something I wanted to do every single day. And it, for many, many years anyways, was really aligned with me, who I was, but it also became who I was.
Did you try anything besides swimming?
Great question. I did field hockey for about 2 months, I think, in eighth grade. And then I tried some camps, you know, sure. like soccer camp, or I think I even did a softball camp. Nothing else stuck. Just wasn't me. The ball sports, definitely not me. Didn't really love the idea of contact mm. in any way. So swimming had a level of contact, but mm. not the same.
Contact with water.
Exactly. Exactly. Sometimes, however, you would, you know, if you're swimming butterfly, you might knock knuckles with sure. somebody, which wasn't pleasant.
No.
I'll say that.
I imagine.
Yeah. But for the most part, no contact, and was pretty good for me on a level. You know, I would consider myself, especially when I was younger, to be on the more shy side. A little bit more introverted, more reserved. And I think that fit me well because of my personality. Mm-hmm. Swimming just worked
gotcha.
With that because you get to have your head in the pool. You got to be in your own world. You know, you're in your own world the whole time. So it did. It did. It really aligned with who I was.
Did you ever consider maybe trying triathlons?
Okay, well.
No, it's a bit of a jump from.
You know, I have successfully one time run a half marathon, which is a really big accomplishment of mine. However, the biking side is where it's just not gonna happen.
Okay. For me, it would be the opposite. It would be cycling, but not so much swimming.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I can ride a bike when it's stabilized.
Sure.
As a child, I fell a few times. That's the issue. I did. I fell a few times. Just my balance wasn't my forte.
Okay.
So I have a bit of a cycling anxiety. I will put that out there.
Gotcha. Well, yeah. I guess if you ever try that endeavor, you feel free to call me.
Perfect.
granted, triathlon's a bit of a pricey kind of sport in comparison to swimming, for sure. I mean, the bike alone, and then you add travel, and then you add shoes, you add clothing, your swim gear, your wetsuit, and everything else. Like, it pretty much adds up quickly.
Yeah.
But congrats on the half marathon.
Thanks. And I did it.
Yeah. Yes, you did.
It's a big deal.
That's more than what I can ever say.
I don't know if I'll ever do it again, but that's okay.
It's one to put in the books.
Exactly.
So with your PhD that you have now, why did you decide to go in the field of psychology, in the field of mental awareness, from your background in swimming? Because you could have taken that anywhere, but why that specifically?
Sure. So my PhD itself is in psychology of human movement, and the specialization is exercise and sport psychology. So I got really specific in my PhD. But right out of college, I went into my master's, which is in general psychology. So I went from this, you know, this background in college of just general psychology, learning every aspect of human behavior, really. And that, I think it stems from, again, from me on a personal level, I've always wanted to understand the why do things work the way they do? Mm-hmm. Why do people behave the way they do? I've always found that so fascinating. So it stemmed from this place of just trying to gain a deeper understanding. And then in time, and because of my athletic experience, you know, I had some of the most incredible moments of my life that come from swimming. I also have some of the most disappointing moments of my life to date from swimming as well. So I think because of some of those experiences and really encountering the trials and, you know, challenges and excitement and joy, I wanted to be able to help others and to support others, other athletes in particular, to get through some of those similar challenges and also similar moments of joy.
Do you also feel just as well that because of your childhood, being that you were only child and being that you were somewhat introverted, that was a bit of a reason just as well to go into that field?
Absolutely. I've always just been a person who is better able to imagine. So imagery is a big part of my work. You know, I had a really great imagination because I was entertaining myself a lot as a child.
Sure.
But it became something that was really easy and really natural to be able to dream up anything I wanted and to see it so clearly. So in that way, I can see that relating. I also am very analytical. Again, I really want to understand and want to pick things apart and just dive deeper in things. And I do feel that that does come back to that sense of introversion or just that more interpersonal nature. Yeah.
I'm seeing that becoming a theme with some of our podcasts as well, that some of the DJs and our producers and our promoters that I interview have a sense of essentially being introverted, just because, like, they're maybe, let's say, shy to perform in front of a crowd. Let's say that's probably more than the most common. But over time, they get used to that and being more aware and being more open, to where, at least from my perspective, it just seems like, I guess, another day in the office, you know?
Yeah, absolutely. And I feel like introverts are super heroes, basically. They have superpowers where introverts tend to be able to adapt really well when it's required, especially if it's for work. Truly, you know, I at work, I am able to come a bit farther out of my shell because I'm given a role. I'm given a purpose. And so that's something that happens for a number of people that identify as an introvert. And over time, the more you do something and the more you're in an environment where you feel like you,
yeah.
you feel authentically yourself and you're around people who bring that out, mm-hmm. it becomes much easier to go a bit more external.
Yeah. And it becomes second nature exactly. just as well. Like just throw another example out there. When I like mountain biking, cycling is kind of like how I grew up as through sport.
Great.
Just because I had a park not too mm-hmm. far, like two or three miles away from where I live. And I just where I still live currently in Newark, Delaware. Iron Hill Park, and like I was there literally yesterday because I feel like I would like to think this kind of resonates with you as well. It's like every once in a while you have to be back on the bike or you have to be back in the pool to kind of like see where your skill level is at and or like kind of make sure that you're kind of like, I don't want to say sharp, but that you still have that kind of like pace or rhythm to where you still feel comfortable in the water or to where you still feel comfortable on the bike. And or just have a little bit of fun.
Sure.
Even if it's for like an hour or so, you know, something mm-hmm. short. You just want to know that, you know, you still have it. You still got it, you know, to a degree.
Yeah.
And it entertains me just as well.
Yeah, that's great.
Did you have any minors when you were growing up in school other than movement and psychology?
No. So in college, I actually started out as exercise science, which in and of itself is about movement as mm-hmm. well in an interesting way. But then I, you know, started taking some courses and I just wasn't feeling great about what I was taking. Didn't feel right. I wasn't doing that great, if I'm being honest, in school. And then I realized, you know, I wanted to switch. I wanted to switch to something else. I think I had a class that was, what was it? It might have been Introduction to Exercise Science, but we talked about sports psychology,
sure.
possibly. And that made me feel, oh, wait, I think I am resonating more with that psychology bit. So that's what led me to change. And the first year I switched over, things were still a little bit challenging. But then the second year, so that was my junior year of college, I was taking all of my main courses and I just loved it. Mm-hmm. I loved school again. It was all just really working well and I felt so good and confident about school for the first time in a while. So no minors, but just really was able to take, you know, a lot of different sources of psychology sure. information. And
when you found that discovery, was that time at Bloomsburg?
Mm-hmm.
Where is yes. that located at?
Bloomsburg, Pennsylvania.
Oh, there you go. Easy enough, right?
So it's up in the mountains, a little bit farther than the Poconos.
Okay.
Yeah, so yeah. where it gets nice and cold in the winter. So imagine walking out of a swim practice in, you know, December, January, February. Some days it was -2, and my hair was wet. It would freeze.
So, snow on the ground.
Yeah, or no snow, but just -2.
Sure.
So it was a bit chilly up there.
Is there kind of like a mini community up there, like a small town or?
Yeah, definitely a small town. Okay. And we would, you know, the people that live there definitely referred to as townies because it just was this small little community.
Mm-hmm. You ever tried skiing up there? I heard this guy, you mean mountains.
Oh, interesting question. No, I have not. Again, I have a biking anxiety and a skiing anxiety. Who would have thought?
Oh, wow.
But there's just some things that aren't worth trying to work itself out.
Agreed. It's for me, it's like I have X amount of hobbies that I can spend my time into, but I don't have this necessarily have the money. Like,
true.
I wish I could do more stuff to my car. Do I have the money for it? No. Don't want to spend time with my car, possibly not starting every day and me having to go to work. No, I don't want to deal with that cumbersome shit, but I don't, you know. As well as other hobbies, but I just, mm-hmm. again, you want to dedicate some time to where you feel it's well spent.
Yeah, definitely.
Now, how do you transition from going from Bloomsburg to University of North Carolina?
Mm-hmm. So I finished swimming in February of 2013.
You were just, we were done, like you were tired.
It was the end. No, yeah. I was done.
Okay.
Like it was, I had my last race in February at our championships, and yeah, that was the end. And about a week later, I got my first acceptance letter to grad school. So it came in a really good time, I will tell you, because my transition was really, really challenging. It truly felt as if the moment I hit the wall for what my body just knew was the last time. It felt like a piece of me died. Felt like a piece of me drifted away in that moment. So getting that acceptance letter a week later felt really comforting, felt really good and exciting. I don't think it was to UNC Wilmington, but it was something.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And then I think it was maybe a week or two later that I got an interview at UNCW, went down there for the interview, wasn't originally going to go there, but at the last minute, I changed my mind. I just felt like it was the right place to go, and it worked out. It was a really wonderful place to be.
Awesome. Did you, what was kind of the hesitation for you to go there, for you to possibly not be there or mm-hmm. to go there? In the first place, was it just location, not being too familiar or like with the curriculum or whatever?
Yeah, that's a great question. I had been accepted to another school. I think it was American University in DC. So it was that one was a bit closer. I would say that was probably part of it. However, I went down there and, you know, I spoke to a couple people, and even though when I left there, I originally was like, yeah, I'm going to go here. This is where I'm going to be.
Sure.
And for whatever reason, in a few weeks, things just weren't working out in the way I had wanted them to, you know, being able to work with, do research with the particular, professors that I had been hoping to, things just weren't working. And I was able to just take a step back and recognize that I think they weren't working for a reason, which was probably my first experience with listening to my gut, listening to my intuition. So I just, you know, I got on the phone with my future mentor at UNCW, had a really good conversation with him. And through that, it allowed me to just change my mind, which in the past I may not have. I may have just stuck with what I had originally planned.
Okay. Like what made you like reaffirm that you were also like meant to be there other than going and talking to coaches?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's actually a great question. One of my friends was actually at the time going into her sophomore year at UNCW on the swim team. So I did, yeah, I grew up with her. I had been friends with her for a couple of years at that point. And I do think that was a part of it as well. You know, I had one person
mm-hmm.
that I felt I could rely on and yeah. that I could connect with, which allowed me once I got there to make other connections, which was really great. So yeah, I would say that was one piece of it. And I had known a couple other people who at one point or another had been there. They had said great things about it. It was also by the beach. We're going to go with that.
Awesome.
That was a big influence. So being by the beach did not hurt my decision. Versus being in a city that was, mm-hmm. you know, pretty busy and things like that. So that was a really great part of it too.
Climate change in a good way.
Yes.
Going from negative to comfortable conditions. I was like maybe to say that. Yes.
Although ironically, my first winter there, it was a record cold winter.
So I should have done one more year in the Poconos.
Oh my gosh. That's just my luck, honestly. So there was we were out of school for about 2 days for ice, just ice.
Just ice.
And so, being from up here in Philadelphia and out towards the Poconos, it was quite comical. However, they didn't have the resources to deal with ice. So,
again, being the theme of comical.
Yeah, exactly.
Did you ever try to take a swim in the ocean as seriously as you would in, let's say, a pool setting?
Oh, no, absolutely not. partially because I don't love the ocean.
Okay.
We've got three things. We've been starting a list of things that I don't love too much.
Now, can some people that come from the pool transition into ocean, kind of ocean swimming discipline.
Sure.
And okay.
Mm-hmm. I would say it is a challenge for some versus others. You know, if someone is better at the distance events mm-hmm. in the pool, so you know, like the mile.
Okay. Yeah. Okay.
Or yep. even like the 500 and above.
Sure.
That may be an easier transition. I, on the other hand, did not swim those distance events, but I swam, you know, middle distance, so like the 200 okay. stroke events, mm-hmm. which to swim butterfly in the ocean is a little challenging.
Yeah, for sure, various reasons.
Yeah.
Now, explain the, if I'm pronouncing this correctly, the mm-hmm. ASAP conference, the AASP conference.
Mm-hmm. ASP, yeah.
ASP.
Yep.
How did you get into that? How did you learn about that and why?
Yeah, sure. So my first conference with the Association for Applied Sports Psychology. Yes. My first conference I went to was the first year I started at Temple, which is where I completed my PhD. And I went, I think it was in October. So it was right after I had started. A group of people in the program were going. It was actually my first conference experience. I had never gone to one before. And so being able to go to that and just be there and hear these wonderful presenters in the field of applied sports psych. So they're working mainly with athletes in the field. So whether that's at a professional level, collegiate, high school, youth, other youth level. Mm-hmm. But it was really enlightening and it was empowering as well and helped me to gain a better sense of awareness of, you know, what type of plan I wanted to have for myself and how I would maybe get there, maybe, because plans change and mine did. So, but it was a great experience.
Did you meet anybody there and how did you become aware of that conference?
Sure. So I became aware of it first from my advisor at Temple, Dr. Michael Sachs, who is
Shout out.
Wonderful. Yes. He's a wonderful, wonderful human. And when I first got there, so I'd just gotten off the plane, and this was when I was very new. I truly had just been around Dr. Sachs for the last 2 or so months, just getting to know him. And he's a very unassuming man, you know, small guy, not over the top, just a man. Sure. He's a good man.
It's all ordinary dude.
Yeah. And when I got there and I was waiting for a shuttle to take a group of people from the airport to our hotel, I was speaking with this individual who I believe he was from Italy, but he was working at Florida State and in psychology, sports psychology. And I mentioned that I am from Temple. He said, "Oh, are you working with Dr. Michael Sachs?" And I said, "Yeah, why?" And I just was like, "Huh, yeah, why?" He said, "Oh, he's incredible." And I said, "I mean, yeah, he is." But truly, that was the first moment that I really gained awareness of, you know, the really incredible things that Dr. Sachs has done in our field. He was one of the, I believe, I may be wrong, but one of the founding members at some point of the ASP conference, possibly. Don't quote me on that, people. But he was there. He was around. He was one of the first few presidents of the organization. And he has a few, I mean, many publications out there, but he's also known for research on the runner's high, which is a really interesting topic. You know, that just when you're running and running and running and you feel like you are floating, mm-hmm. you are out of this world. So in the zone. So that's some of the research he's done.
Is there a swimmer's high? Is there such thing?
I don't know. For me personally, I'm going to say no. Okay. It doesn't mean you can't get into this great flow state, mm-hmm. which I have been in swimming, not often, but a couple of times. But I'm not sure, actually, if there's a swimmer's high.
There's definitely a cycling high, I would like mm-hmm. to think, especially for road disciplines. Now, granted, my background is more for mountain biking disciplines, so going off-road and okay. going over rocks and logs and stuff like that. Just by having that kind of consistent like movement
mm-hmm, right.
over time, and you're just like concentrating on various things, your line choice, your heart rate, and everything kind of goes in sync.
Okay.
To a degree.
Yeah. So I could see that then being something for swimming, it's possible it could be happening more for those in the ocean, right? For mm-hmm. long distance
right.
swimmers versus the high intensity
right.
bursts of energy swimming. Right. I would say it's a bit harder there.
Now, going into Temple mm-hmm. around that time, did you already, how many years of college did you complete, have university did you complete? And was you at master's or were mm-hmm. you at bachelor level?
Yeah, so I did 4 years at Bloomsburg in psychology,
mm-hmm.
2 years at UNCW also for general psychology for my master's degree. And so then this was my 7th year of school mm-hmm. out of high school when I started at Temple.
Now, did you ever go back to the conference or was that just kind of the one time to where you just absorbed all this information, you kind of everything clicked for you at that time? Or did you keep going back?
Yes. Yeah. I went back every year that I was at Temple. This was actually the first year I did not go, just for traveling reasons. But I was there, yeah, I guess 4 years in a row, and a couple really great places. So got to go to Disney World for the first time since I was 5. Awesome. Also, I think Phoenix, Arizona and Toronto.
Also. Yeah. Oh, my God. Mm-hmm. So Disney World, Florida. Correct.
Yes, in okay, Florida. Yeah.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
How was that? I've only been to Six Flags. Sorry. I've only been to Hershey Park. Sorry. I've only been to Dorney Park. Sorry. I know it's up to not that Disney standard, but was it everything it lived up to be? Did it live up to the hype? I would like to think it did in various ways.
It's pretty
ways.
Great. Okay. Yeah. Well, also because I was able to go with 2 of my closest friends that I met through Temple and hadn't seen them for a number of months because mm-hmm. they graduated. So they were, you know, at mm-hmm. home and doing wonderful things out in the world. So we all met at the airport in Disney World or in Florida.
Yes.
And, you know, so that was a really wonderful experience. But then as adults, we got to go do the adult things at Disney sure. World, which meant we got to drink around the world. Awesome. I will tell you that.
Was that your favorite ride?
It was pretty cool. Well, it wasn't a ride. It was that you got to go to all these different quote-unquote countries where they had different drink options and also different food options. So it was a really cool experience where you truly felt that each time you moved on, you were experiencing a different culture. It was very cool.
Now, year was that year would take?
That was
Disney World.
2017.
So mm-hmm. it was the same time you met Eric. How did you it meet was. Eric and how did that come about?
Yeah. Yeah. It was not only the year I met Eric, it was the year I went to my first music festival.
Awesome. Did you meet him there?
Yes.
And what did you see? Who did you see?
Oh, who? Okay. The reason I went was because I saw Zed on the lineup and I never even had an awareness of music festivals, if that makes sense.
Sure.
For whatever reason.
Did you even know who Zed was?
Oh, I knew who Zed was. Okay. That was a part of it, sure. is that my friends were going and I had just kind of started connecting with those friends again,
mm-hmm.
but they were going to this a week later, I tell you. So I bought tickets a week before. But, you know, I saw Zed on the lineup and then I saw a few other names. I said, okay, yeah, this could be really amazing. So I bought tickets while I was out at night on a Saturday. I bought tickets for the next week and ended up going. So I think I saw Zed, Galantis, Audion, Tritonal, Illenium, a lot of other ones that I just can't remember right now, but it was a really wonderful experience because I've always loved music, but I've never really experienced something mm-hmm. like a music festival.
Coming out of it, how long was the festival? Was it 1 day, 2 day?
It was a 3 day, but I just went for 2, which was for the best because 2 days was plenty
right,
for
agree.
The first time. Yeah.
I often think of these kind of long, drawn-out music festivals. It's kind of like, by the end of it, it's kind of like an episode of The Weird World. Where everybody wants to, like, kick each other's teeth in and just, like, go in their own separate room or direction to where it's like, I'm just done with you. I don't want to do something else with my life to a degree.
You're not wrong.
Yeah, especially if, like, you're confined to, like, a camper or an RV.
That's true. We did not camp, but still, you are either in a hotel room or an Airbnb or someone's apartment in close quarters with people, and that's true. You absolutely get tired of your friends.
but thankfully, you're comfortable. Well-maintained space. You're in a bed.
Yes.
There's probably like a breakfast bar downstairs. That's far away, so it's convenient.
Yes.
In that manner,
mm-hmm.
and you don't have to worry about weather.
Yeah. Oh, yes. Because it did rain. I remember that. It did. It poured the second night. Mm-hmm.
Now, where was the music festival again? It was in Florida, correct?
No, it was in New York.
It was in New York. Mm-hmm. Okay. Gotcha. Yeah.
Yep.
Was it a bit cold, a bit chilly, or was it a bit hot?
Steamy? It was cold the second day. So the first day was great and didn't rain. Really wonderful. Was super excited. Second day also super excited, but a bit more tired. Little bit colder, and then it rained.
Now, from when the music festival ended, how did you pick up those artists musically? Did you begin to listen to that some sort of genre of electronic music and or other genres of music just as well? Like, how did the music impact you beyond just those 3 days,
mm-hmm.
beyond that time that you were there?
So I have actually always listened to electronic dance music. Always, always, always. Since I would say my 10th grade year, at least. So 2006-ish, 2007. Daft Punk got me into EDM and will keep me in EDM for the rest of my life. I will always go back to Daft Punk whenever I really need it and want it. So I've always listened to it. And I've always known that I loved and resonated with that music. But again, I just didn't have an awareness of the festival mm-hmm. experience. I even, now that we're talking about it, I even went to underground raves in high school. But I never, again, I didn't have an awareness of mm-hmm. what it meant
what it was.
To be a rave.
Sure.
I just went because my friends were going. It was music. It was fun. And it was definitely in like these weird places in my around my high school. But it was really cool. So again, always into it, but that festival life was very different. But when I did go, or the week before I went to, it was Electric Zoo festival. So the week before, what I did was I got on, whether it was iTunes or, yeah, I guess I've always really used iTunes. So I got onto iTunes and I just downloaded as much music by the artists mm-hmm. that I was seeing as possible. So I loved having, you know, an idea of what I was going to be listening to. So I know I downloaded a lot of Audion, a lot of Tritonal.
Mm-hmm.
So those were my two favorite sets. I was really excited to see them. And then you're right. I went from there. After the fact, I did go back and I looked into the other artists more mm-hmm. and just started getting more and more excited about dance music.
Now, was it only then to where it came to like a realization to you to where, hey, this can help me in a psychological kind of way to where it can impact my sports psychology and my movement kind of thought? And if it did, how did it resonate with you?
So this was definitely not the first time that I've ever thought about that, especially when it came to swimming in high school in particular. So, you know, in high school, I think was around the time that iPods came out. So I petitioned my father for an iPod. I wanted one so bad. I may have possibly even given him a speech, like literally written a speech about why I should get an iPod or why he should get me an iPod, so that I could have all of the music I really liked in one spot. And so I started listening to music all the time. I had headphones on while walking to class. So my high school was very large, by the way. So we had to walk between campuses. There were two separate campuses. So if I had to do that, I had my headphones in.
Sure.
Or even if we weren't supposed to, I like hid my headphones.
Of course.
Through the sweatshirt kind of situation. So I was always listening to music. And I think that's truly because music might be the one thing that I don't feel overly inclined to understand. I think it's something that just allows me to be and to feel, but I don't have to think about it that much.
You don't have to kind of, you don't have to explain it.
No.
It's just there.
It is. And how beautiful is that? So I think this introvert over here who was constantly in her head, constantly analyzing so much, which if you can imagine, tends to lead to anxiety, if we're being honest. When you're overthinking things, you're worrying, ruminating,
for sure,
really just being very critical in your own mind, that tends to lead to things such as anxiety. Music allowed me to hop out of that state maybe hop out of my head and into my body more so, to get more in touch with, again, my feelings and the way I felt in my body, which was really amazing and really stood in contrast to any other time when I didn't have my headphones in. So it's always been there for me. Music has always been there. But I just began to appreciate it in a new way once I started having more experience, right, going to festivals, going to shows, going to events just with friends and things like that.
It felt more visceral. It felt more,
yes,
like existing, to where it's like, oh, there's more to this whole music thing than what I'm listening to on my iPod and my headphones. It's like it can be potentially life-changing and or thought-provoking.
Yes.
In that same regard, to where it's that rhythm can kind of carry you along and whatever path it might take you, for better or for worse.
Yes, exactly.
Now, I would like to think that Eric came along with you during those festivals.
Yeah, so since I met him at the first one, I have only been to one festival, which I only went to for one day, but with a good friend of mine.
Sure.
That's the only one I've been to without him. So it really has become our shtick, basically. And same with just shows in general. Music is something we really share, we really connect over, and is definitely a big part of both of our lives.
Now, how did you get here to Philly, where you currently reside now?
How did I get here?
How did you get here, and why did you decide to stay in Philly rather than go and stay in Bucks County that you were originally from?
Yeah, so when I got into my program at Temple, you know, I did have the choice to live at home, and now there's moments where I feel like I should have, to save some money. But we can't go back now, so it is what it is. But a friend of mine who I actually swam with in high school connected with me, and she was hoping to move to Philadelphia. And I think I had posted on my Facebook, you know, I got into Temple, I was moving back home. And so she connected with me, and we decided to move in together in Old City, Philadelphia, which was wonderful. I did love living there, and I loved the city in general. I moved home for about 6 months at one point when I moved out of that apartment and was just trying to figure out where it was I wanted to be in the city. But throughout my time at Temple, I stayed here. And now I am still working in the same job I was working at last year, which is at Drexel University. So over in University City in Philly. And so right now that is what's keeping me here, but it is also home. It truly feels like home.
Now, you've bounced around from Bucks County to the Poconos to North Carolina to Philadelphia, traveling to Florida and all these other places. Do you feel that travel can be just as much as an antidote for whatever you're thinking that might be detrimental to you, just as much as music?
Yes. I love traveling. Yeah. Traveling is really, really wonderful. And yeah, I think it has a similar quality where it allows you to get out of your head while you're traveling. Mm-hmm. You know, you do go a bit more external. It doesn't force you, but it makes you want to be more in the moment and to really acknowledge your environment and be right where your feet are, rather than being stuck in your head and, again, ruminating about something silly or yep. dumb you did 5 minutes ago, or what you're going to be doing 2 weeks from now. So yeah, being able to travel, because it's really a privilege yep. that I've been able to travel, has been a really wonderful experience too.
And now being the older cat that I am now, it's like, I don't want to spend money on like dumb shit. Yes, it's like, yeah, right. It's like, I want to plan this trip out mm-hmm. with somebody
yeah.
to this foreign exotic place, at least in my eyes.
Sure.
And kind of find my inner self, because what I'm noticing, especially when I travel overseas, like I'm somebody who I'm not, but yeah, for the better. Okay. Mm-hmm. Like I'm asking these random questions to these random people
mm-hmm.
and trying right. to learn the culture in that same sense. What I also find with travel just as much is that, you know, you get to, at least from guidebooks, learn about famous landmarks, food, nightlife, but not so much music. Maybe perhaps okay. the nightlife section endeavors a little bit about it, but not too much.
Sure.
Like, for example, like when I went over in London,
mm-hmm.
like I knew about Big Ben, I knew about some St. Paul's Cathedral, I knew about the Tate Modern Art Gallery, all of which were wonderful things, but like I couldn't find let's say XOYO in the guidebook. I couldn't find fabric, you know, mm-hmm. I couldn't find Ministry of Sound within, you know, sure. within these guidebooks. It's like, where do you find all that stuff? It's so I resorted to RA, to Resident Advisor.
Okay.
And
yeah.
kind of use that as my guide, my musical kind of guide, and kind right. of learn the culture through going out.
Cool.
Through those yes. times and through those nightclubs and having good times and good experiences there. And through that, you can also find yourself
mm-hmm.
in degree just right. as much as music. Now, there was times where I was being critical just as much as myself.
Mm-hmm.
I would like to think some of your clientele to where like it's overly bearing. Like, let's say, let's go with sports. Let's sure. go along with that theme. Like, if I didn't train properly, at least in my own head, I would feel a bit down
mm-hmm.
on myself. Like, oh man, you should have done one more lap more clean. Or you should have changed up your power stroke to a degree. Or you should have taken a route that was more harder on you, to where you can gain more experience or work on whatever to make you feel better. But there's, I mean, when it comes down to race day, it's like, everything's on the line, and you kind of, as soon as the gun goes off, it's just like, it's kind of a blur to mm-hmm. that degree. It's like, can you train for a blur?
That's a great question.
You can't really fathom that until you're in the moment. And despite all the stuff, the statistics you may have through, let's say, a heart rate monitor or a power meter, there's no comprehending what your mind understands in this like kind of rapid moment. It may be an hour, but it feels like 20 minutes. You know what I mean?
Yeah, you do lose track of time often, and that's actually something that happens if you do get into a flow state. Mm-hmm. So again, with some of these sports, it's easier than others to get mm-hmm. into a flow state. I would argue that cycling might be one of those, same with running. And again, I experienced flow in swimming, and that's truly when you're so in the zone, you're so in the moment that all of these other things kind of mm-hmm. go out the window. And one of those aspects is, you know, time not making any sense. Mm-hmm. Time kind of just flies by.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And with the help of your Facebook, for every once in a while, on occasion, you do go live with your Facebook, and just kind of putting that knowledge and kind of putting everything in perspective in a very understandable and pleasant and kind way, to where people who are watching can kind of absorb that. And you definitely helped me out with that,
because
I was kind of in a little bit of a rut myself.
Sure.
Kind of with me my own kind of psychological state. Like, I was being way too critical mm-hmm. of some aspects of DJing, to where I was like, I was kind of questioning myself.
Okay.
And being overly bearing. And I also will say this, shout out to Carl Salas if you're watching, because like, we have a little Facebook group, and his kind of thought-provoking just jokes, like just being not so serious about the smallest of shit,
mm-hmm.
definitely helps out. just well, I'm just laughing at kind of yourself and laughing at things that aren't so like critical. It's like you're eating your own head to a degree.
Right.
Do you find with athletes, whether regardless of sport, are kind of in their within their own heads, if they don't have kind of a coach to kind of guide them or don't have kind of friends to kind of push them?
Yeah, I would say it's much easier anyways. Whether it happens or not is definitely dependent on that person, but it's much easier to get swept away or to get caught up in your thinking and in that critical style of thinking. So you, I'm going to even, you know, highlight something that you said, which was the word should. I should have done this. I should have done more, or I could have done more. So especially that word should, I tend to highlight that for athletes when they do bring it up, because with the word should comes a lot of shame. So SH and SH. It's, you can even think of the word should as shushing you. It's shushing you. Truly. It's telling you to be quiet. It's putting you down in a way that just feels so bad, when in reality we can find a way to jump out of that and to shift into this new paradigm of thinking and playfulness. So what you were describing about Carlos. Hi, Carlos. So what you were describing right there is this playfulness, this lightness that is more than okay to have, that is more than okay to bring in to your life in general, but also to these more, whether it be competitive realms, performance realms, when you bring playfulness in, it gives you some space or frees you up a bit from the shoulds, from the critical eye or the self critic, the inner critic.
Are there any particular kind of mental exercises or physical exercises that can help the athlete potentially go on a stray on a different path to where they're not so critical of themselves, to where they can kind of practice a certain movement or practice a certain thought process to get them on the right track?
Mm-hmm. So when I'm talking to, I know you're right, this could be referring to anybody. This could be all sports. So at Drexel, I work with 18 different teams. So that's lots of sports.
That's not that bad.
I know, it's fine. It's okay. it's no big deal. But it's a lot of different teams, you know, team sports, individual sports, male sports, female sports, so many different versions.
Do you have a favorite?
Ooh, I can't. No, I can't say.
Okay.
I can't say that.
Okay.
On
we'll leave it at that. Go Drexel.
Exactly. Go Drexel. Love it. No, I do love working with them all, if I'm being honest, because it's just every team gives me a new experience and I've grown in different ways from each experience, which is really cool. But then it also can truly refer to anyone that's performing. Like we're saying, human beings, even though sometimes I feel like that should be, should. See, there I go. Myself out. We refer to ourselves as human beings, and yet we're constantly doing. So really, we should be human doings, in my opinion, if we're not allowing ourselves to just be. But we can go on another tangent about that later. But, you know, all human beings are performers in some way. They're doing all these different types of things. And so I'll usually help individuals that are being quite critical by identifying that inner critic or the voice of the inner critic. So would you like to do an example?
Sure.
Okay. All right. So take a second to bring up in your mind a couple of those critical thoughts that you were just, you know, starting to think about. Really envision those thoughts coming in. How do they make you feel? Do they make you feel tense? Do they make you angry? Do they make you feel sad and disappointed in yourself? And even start to really hear the tone of that voice, if you can, as if it's coming from another person. Can you hear a tone at all to it?
I feel nervousness.
Okay.
I feel a little bit of a shame.
Mm-hmm.
to the point where others can kind of notice it because I'm asking all these questions
okay.
that are somewhat relevant, but mostly kind of irrelevant to what the subject matter is. It's just kind of like a mirror of feeling.
Okay, sure.
And I feel at the time it's helping to benefit the cause, but I don't see that. It's only kind of masking what's inside rather than benefiting anybody.
Right. Okay. So those are those feelings that you're getting from it. Can you give me an example of the thought that you kind of brought up? What is the thought? What is it saying to you?
It's saying to me personally that you should do a certain action because it's only really... It's helping you in a small, minute way, but in my own head, the small things add up to one big thing. So if I have a million questions about something that's infinitely small, I feel like it may help you or help me in a big way, even though it's annoying the person who I'm talking to. It could be something about DJing to where it's like, well, how do we promote this event?
Okay.
But I would just nitpick. To the point where just people are paying attention, but in reality, I should come up with a more simple way, a more generic kind of way to find that out.
Okay. So that to me, and I'm going to make an assumption so you can tell me if I'm wrong. That to me sounds like if it were another person telling you that, sounds like that person's tone is kind of naggy, maybe even a little, I don't know if condescending is the right word, but like naggy, harping, like really trying to just get you to keep going and going and going. I don't know. Talk to me about that.
That's how I would feel. Mm-hmm. But in reality, it's just more like questioning, not questioning. It's kind of like questioning an authority to a degree. Okay. Like, is he or her right?
Okay.
And even
so
though
the voice is an authority, is that what you're saying?
Correct. And I believe their opinion.
Yeah.
But I'm always like generally by myself.
Okay.
And I always have my own way of thinking to the point where I'm kind of ignorant of everybody else's opinion. But at the time, I'm very much unaware of that. And so I'm just bouncing opinions back and forth. And it's good conversation. Don't get me wrong. And we're all helping each other out. But it's a very kind of like drawn out process.
Okay. Which now granted, I don't see anything wrong with in certain situations. However, you're still being critical of that.
Yes.
In whether it's in the moment or after the fact or whatever. So we've gotten to kind of the source of that quote unquote voice of the inner critic. It seems to be coming off as this authoritative, like, do this. You need to be doing this. You should be doing this. You should be asking this question.
Yes.
We got it. Okay. So now I want you to attempt to, again, bring that authoritative voice really into your mind, feel it in your body, hear what it's saying. And then, as if that voice is coming from another human being, give it a name.
Can that name be like... Give me an example of a name.
A person's name.
Oh, okay. Okay.
So it's, again, authoritative figure. You should do this. You need to be asking that.
Okay, that authoritative figure, I guess, would be named Simon. How about that?
Okay, we're going to go with Simon. Perfect.
Sure.
So again, this is the process I'll normally take some athletes through when they're starting to describe that they have this really critical inner critic coming in. And so once we get to a name, and usually what tends to happen is I already start to get them feeling a little bit playful because they laugh. Usually my athletes are like, huh? Because it feels a little, I don't know whether it's a little embarrassing to them or they're like, this is strange, but I don't care. All I care about is that it's starting to allow them to feel a little playful and a little comical. Great. That's the point. Because like you were saying earlier, if we can bring that feeling, that playful vibe to some of this heavier stuff, and something that doesn't have to be heavy, but it becomes right. heavy, then again, we're opening them up to get more space from it, and in turn allowing them to, you know, it gives them a moment to question that inner critic. So that's the next step.
Can I describe Simon?
Sure. Please. Oh my goodness.
The Simon is a person who is in a realm of his or her own existence, to where he or her to where Simon is basically his own person, his own kind of like guard and passerby and friend. And sometimes Simon can get tunnel vision to where everything's blurred out for better or for worse. And it's not just on the bike per se. It's also kind of, it can be a little bit of a lifestyle, to where it's a little bit of a thrill, but mostly an experience to where Simon only experiences it in his own head, because where Simon lives, everybody else around Simon doesn't do the same things as Simon does. And yeah. Simon always wanted to find somebody who's kind of fits that bill, but never quite did. And people close to Simon are aware of the activities that Simon does, but doesn't really acknowledge it as a lifestyle. And so Simon does his own thing and constantly does it to the point where he is the only one aware of the most minute kind of movements in his lifestyle and or profession, to the point where he can make a career out of it, but he's the only one who knows, and he's the only one who loves that kind of passion, I guess.
Yeah. Simon sounds like a bit of a black sheep.
Yeah.
Which I definitely resonate with. I love that description. Thank you for that.
Anything else would you like to know about Simon? What would you go with Simon?
Yeah, so you mentioned that Simon seems to have a bit of tunnel vision. So that's actually pretty classic for something like what we're talking about. That inner critic that is... So the inner critic, by the way, tends to be developed through, you know, having certain experiences in your life, having standards to compare to, and then it often comes from these expectations that, again, we must gain through experience. So if you think about a child, a young child,
sure,
like we're talking real little, they do not have an inner critic, okay? They don't have a Simon, right? They don't. They will... I have a perfect example. One of our coaches had to bring her 3-year-old son to a session last year, and with a whole team of girls.
Sure.
So, you know, little boys sometimes can get a little funny around girls, right? However, one, he was wonderfully behaved, but... If he had an inner critic, as he was sitting there eating, I think he was eating an apple. And if he had had an inner critic, his inner critic might have been like, "You're so embarrassing. Put the apple down. Why are you eating it like that? Everyone's looking at you." But he was just eating that apple, eating it, being there, reading his book about dragons, still eating the apple, looking at all the girls, smiling, laughing, still eating the apple, because that he doesn't have those expectations yet. He doesn't have the experience in his life that may have led to that critical voice. Let's all be like that little boy, but that's not so easy. Because again, as adults, we've just had experience after experience that has developed this inner voice, and it is what it is. So, like you were saying about the tunnel vision, when we're feeling or experiencing a negative emotion, that tends to be when tunnel vision gets the most narrow. Our vision gets really narrow if we're feeling into that negative emotion or being overwhelmed by it even. But when we're able to, you know, shift or reframe or question that voice, those thoughts that are coming in, we begin to turn that vision into something broader. It opens up, it widens, you're able to see a bit more, experience a bit more, and make new choices about how you want to respond, or choices about what you want to think, what you want to bring in. So all of that really is a process by which, again, we have to hear Simon, we have to acknowledge Simon, we can't just tell, we can't just force him out the door, right? We have to say, hey, Simon, what's up? How you doing? Take a seat, right? And then genuinely be like, hold on. Are those things that you're saying, do I believe those? Do I really believe those? Is that reality? Or is that just the story that you're telling me? So we have the opportunity when we give ourselves some space from it or have awareness of this critical voice to come into the present moment, acknowledge it, ask it to take a seat, and we can disagree. We can be like, you're lying. That's a lie. Lie, lie, lie. And we can question it and change it.
Now, is step one acknowledgement, acknowledging that person is in that room, that Simon is in that room?
Yeah. Yeah, it's definitely an awareness. You must have an awareness of those things as they come and go, as much as possible. So an awareness and acknowledgement is absolutely the first step.
It's almost like going into AA. It's like, hey, I'm Eric. I'm an alcoholic. Like, to it again. I'm not an alcoholic. But you...
That was,
and
no,
Eric is not
an
alcoholic, but you yes. understand where I'm coming from.
Yes.
But just acknowledging that is there in the first place brings you a step forward.
For sure. You have it, and because it's okay.
Right.
And things, for example, you know, a big emotion for some people is fear. And while it is challenging to face fears, literally and figuratively, we're not going to be able to move through fear or anxiety even if we don't first become aware of that fear and anxiety and what it's trying to tell us.
Now, I would like to think this is very much person to person.
Mm-hmm.
But for the people who you interact with at Drexel, is it kind of like a daily kind of thing to where sports teams are acknowledging that you have to step in to where it's like almost in line with their training? Or is it kind of like a methodical, let's take time away from what you're doing right now and let's just sit down kind of thing?
So you're spot on that it's definitely person to person. You know, this is something I've done, this activity in particular, I have done in a team setting. So we've done it as a whole to give them.
How's that dynamic?
It's fine. It works. You know, the team situations pose some really good advantages, but also some, you know, some disadvantages sometimes just because some of the teams I work with are large, right? Which is hard. However, you know, by giving them the opportunity to learn that strategy, and if it really resonates with them and they find it useful and they feel it's necessary, they will use it. They will be able to do that. However, I do feel, especially about something like this, it is best addressed in a one-on-one setting.
Sure.
So we are able to go a little bit deeper and, you know, get into the nuances, similarly how you shared, you know, your background and how you, what you feel about
Simon
is. Right. That's not something we can do as easily in a team setting. So doing it, you know, in a one-on-one setting, I feel is a really great way to dive a little bit deeper, and for them to start putting that into practice by the end of our session.
Awesome. Also, with that same kind of principle, do you feel that, being that you have that background in sport, that this can also apply to other kind of psychological aspects, to where like it can be beneficial to almost anybody to help benefit them in whatever they're going through.
Absolutely. I'm pretty sure this strategy comes from more of a counseling background even, or counseling field. And so I may have gotten it actually in my counseling class. But it's an interpersonal skill, you know, it's an interpersonal tool, a tool in your toolbox, and it just allows you, anyone truly can get more aware, get more in touch with this inner critic if it's something that they have, because granted, not everyone has one.
Have you done counseling online by chance, to where like having like an actual like counseling session where we go over, we discuss Simon more thoroughly online, and or do you feel there's any benefit of doing that, or do you feel there's any kind of detrimental benefits of doing it online, to a point where it's not as satisfying to do it online as it is one-on-one? Let's say where you and me right now, like we're like sitting next to each other having a conversation, is there anything to where it's like what are the benefits and negatives, I should say, of doing it online?
Sure. I do just want to clarify. So I'm not a counselor, just to be
clear. Someone out there.
And that's, yeah, I just want to put that out there, ethically. Yep. So I'm not a, you know, I'm not a trained therapist or licensed therapist. However, I still do those, yeah, the mental performance and that mindset training. So I have done some stuff online, and I am currently, you know, moving my own personal business forward, which will be all online. It will be online based. And I've done some things with my current athletes. You know, sometimes their schedules just don't work. So sometimes we have to do some stuff online through video calls. And I've also, I even recorded my first podcast. So about 2 weeks ago now. Sure. And I did it with her online. She's living in Manchester. So she's, you know, on the other across the ocean. And I feel that something that's important to acknowledge is, one, we're not all going to connect well in general. So therefore, if you are talking with somebody that you are connected with and that you're aligned with, the interface isn't relevant. So the moments and times when I have done things virtually, and they've been with people that I'm very aligned with, and they're very aligned with me, it goes just as nicely as the dynamic does face to face in person. Okay. Mm-hmm. So, you know, there's been times where it hasn't worked, but it's something you just have to recognize, that it's like you can't be friends with everyone either. So Sometimes certain dynamics aren't meant to work, and that is okay. So that's something I've had to get used to lately.
Gotcha. Now I'm going to go back to that kid in swim practice.
Sure.
To where everybody was like attracting his attention. Is it kind of like letting go is a sense of being on that kind of different path, to where you're being positive about yourself? But I know that you mentioned earlier that we're adults and we kind of have to pick and choose. What is it that just being human kind of, and just being yourself, how does that help in this modern day and age, to where everything's kind of being like transmitted, you know, over IM and text and email, to the point where you may be able to keep up or may not be able to keep up? How is it just being human still relevant today?
Yeah. So we all put off energy.
Okay.
In general, wherever you are at any point in time, whether you can feel it or not. You know, some people aren't in tune with others' energy, which is okay. I also just saw something before you got here that said intuition is the highest form of intelligence, which I did not read the article. I will admit to it right now.
It was a good headline.
It's a great headline. And, you know, intuition is something that I'm pushing forward into more. I'm like trying to align more with my own intuition. So, but that goes really nicely along with this idea that we do put off energy, And if we tune into it, we can feel other people's energy. And that is why I feel, you know, bringing, or one, having an understanding of who you are on an authentic level is very important, because we can put that authentic energy into the world and others will receive it. So again, despite some of these, you know, new age interfaces and ways of communicating, I think if we can come back to an understanding of who am I on an authentic level? What is my true self? What do I want to put off and put out into the universe? Because then it's also something that we tend to get back.
Mm-hmm. Now, I'm not a big basketball kind of guy, mm-hmm. but Kobe Bryant has recently passed.
Yeah.
And we're feeling that energy, like, yes. being broadcasted for sure over, yes. like, all the accomplishments that this man has brought. His family, you know, what he brought to the team, and through his sponsors and everything else, we're seeing that being broadcast. It makes everybody want to go on that path and try to resemble. Excuse me. Again, once again, sorry, you can hear the burps of the mic, but try to resemble the man that he was, and through his ups and downs, and trying to become a better human through that. It's, you know. I have a lot of people whom I looked up to, whether it being through sport, whether it being through music. And that helps me just as well. Like, just setting an example makes kind of me being here more worthwhile, and or me be wanting to kind of push myself or find my own kind of way through that kind of direction. Certainly something to be aware of and look up to just as well.
Yeah. Do you mind actually talking a little bit about a couple of those people that you do look up to? I'd love to hear that.
Sure. What's one? Let's say Matt Hoffman. Matt Hoffman, famous BMX rider. Dave Mira, who recently passed, who was also a BMX rider, triathlete, mm-hmm. Family man. Tony Hawk. Bradley Mullen. Let's say Lance Armstrong, sure. DJ Biz, who helped me DJ. Shout out to DJ Biz. I interviewed you episode 2. Hope you're doing good, my friend. Literacy. I want to say it's like a countless amount of people. It's like through music, but through sport. Nino Shirter. Famous mountain biker, like, I still killing it. He's like number one in the World Cup, in cross country. You kind of put me on, like, I'm like trying to name all these people, but it's like I'll never get to the end of the list.
Well, it's like you're accepting an Oscars speech. We're gonna have to cut you off.
Just cut me off.
Yeah, start sure. playing the Oscars music. Yeah.
But in general, a lot of people through sport, a lot of people sure. through music, a lot of people through just everyday life.
Yeah.
It's like everybody has their own kind of flavor. I've picked up on every single flavor to the point where it's kind of like one big blur.
Mm-hmm.
But everybody's helped me along the way.
Right.
Definitely, like, thank you, I guess.
Yeah, that's some nice gratitude right there. Cool.
But what were you leading into that? Why was
I just, you know, I think you did make a really great point. You know, it's important to think about that. It's important to acknowledge some of the people, some of the role models that helped guide your journey, even if they weren't, you know, right there with you actually guiding you. You just were able to tune into their energy. Yeah. I'm telling you, that's what it is. You're tuning into their energy. You feel aligned with their energy. And that was really helpful to you. So that's a really cool part of your story.
And a lot of people whom I grew up reading about, it was just a lot of people, I should say, idolized. Like, I just learned about them through reading, just through magazines, and just, like, kind of picking up on, like, how they kind of, like, sort themselves out, and whether in a business setting or through sport or just through everyday life. It's just, like, I kind of interpreted their lifestyle in my own way and just kind of picked up on that. Now, granted, you shouldn't, a lot of people say you shouldn't, like, talk to your idols, or, like, because if you, like, somehow talk to them, you might get a misconstrued way or a different way of you thinking of them, like, in the best of times. but I never really encountered those people all that often. But the ones I do, I just as much as I read about them, they were like true to what they were, which was cool.
Yeah, that's nice.
Thankfully, it's like for like meeting like Layback Luke over in Atlantic City.
You met
Layback? Yeah, I got him to sign my autograph. Yeah, I was
among. Cool,
yeah, that was super duper cool.
That's really cool.
Admittedly, he's a little bit shorter. he looks a little bit taller. Okay. from all the interviews and all the YouTube videos that he's done on his YouTube channel.
Mm-hmm.
Layback Luke. And cool dude, he taught me a thing or two just about touring in general and how that schedule is very grinding to the point where, you know, it could be detrimental. Like, let's say Avicii. That's a good example.
That's really weird because that was just in my mind as you were saying that. I told you, energy.
Yeah.
You were reading my energy right
and,
there.
And, you know, how that could be detrimental
yeah.
to...
Right.
A person's lifestyle in the very like serious way.
Right.
A couple, I think Don Diablo maybe.
Love him. He's one of my favorite
he's
DJs.
Fantastic. Yes. Some artists starting with a D. Maybe it's Diorro.
Okay.
I think.
Mm-hmm.
I could be wrong, but in general, basically a lot of artists are feeling that kind of grind through that tour schedule.
Yeah.
And that feeling of just trying to keep up with everything else that's going on. It's just like every once in a while, I do have to step back from the shaft, from the limelight, and just kind of endeavor in your own kind of path and go back to where you were in the very kind of clear way.
Yeah, definitely. I think that's a really great lesson in so many different ways. And so this is my second year at Drexel, and you know, my first year was great, and I did learn so much. However, the one thing that I found myself doing was saying yes to everything. You know, yes, I'll do that. Yes, I'll be there.
Yeah.
And now I'm not saying that that isn't, or that's something you should full on avoid, because I think as you're getting started, it makes sense to an extent.
Right.
However, I eventually found myself getting tension headaches every day. So bad right in the center of my head every single day. And then I even eventually was getting, you know, digestive issues and like all these physical symptoms of what I'm almost certain was truly just chronic stress, because I was putting so much stress on my mind and body, especially with what I do. You know, again, I'm not doing therapy, but I am experiencing people's emotions head on. So finding a way to this past year to set some boundaries, set some limits. Like I take off every Friday and I have no exceptions every Friday because it's just something I needed to do. So doing things like that make sense and also fit into my work, you know, it's been a really helpful thing to acknowledge.
Now, how is the website growing? How are you, how's that coming along?
Mm-hmm. It's going. I'm going to go with that. So right now I'm still in the learning phases of everything with my business because, you know, 10 years of school out of high school, not one business class. Look at that. Super fun. So learning it though, learning the nuances of business and what it even means to be a business owner, what it takes to be a business owner, you know, that consistency of showing up. And putting your message out in a way that is bringing in what my business coach, who I'm working with now, calls soul clients. You know, like we were talking about.
Oh.
I love it, right?
Love it. Yes.
It's great.
I know. I'm aware of that word.
I love it.
Even though I don't have a business background, but I'm aware.
Yeah. It's so nice because it just means, one, you're not meant to work with everybody on the planet. That wouldn't make sense. Let's be honest. But there are certain people out there that you are meant to work with. And so if you're constructing your content and your message with those people in mind, the idea is that it will bring in those people that you will be aligned with. That way your work together truly will be transformative because the relationship, and she even says, you know, the contract for them to work with you is already signed, which I love. It's so intuitive and awesome. I think it's brilliant. So those are all the details that I'm learning right now And I'm really just gaining some confidence and a better understanding of the message and of who I do want to work with in this life.
Once you find that soul clientele, is there such thing as like a soul kind of customer to where like you bring them aboard, you tell them what they're about, and they pick up on the most nuanced things to the point where it's like a ride, and they just keep riding on that ride to the point where it's like, oh, they found what they were looking for and more to more to where they're like a lifetime kind of customer of yours to a degree.
So I wouldn't say lifetime customer because I would say
customer,
client, but client, still.
Yeah.
So, you know, my intention with my business is, so on the one hand, I do my work at Drexel with current athletes.
Yes.
And on the other hand, because of my own personal experience with the transition out of sport, with it being, again, related to a death or a loss, it's led me to recognize that I do want to help support athletes as they navigate life after sport. So that's what I'm going to be doing in my business. And finding a way to support them, help them, guide them, assist them, whatever word you really want to use. It could be many different forms. But the goal is that one day they won't need me. One day they won't want me there every moment of their week, and that's good. That's okay. Mm-hmm. I think in the past when I had to think about, you know, someone being like basically breaking up with you, they're basically like, I don't want to work with you anymore. It's not necessarily a bad thing. It means they've grown. How cool. Yes. So that's my goal for sure.
Do you have a business plan lined up? Like, how is it going with your business coach as far as that is concerned?
Yeah, so I'm not going to give too many details.
No, we can't.
Because I'm keeping things, you know, pretty close to the chest. But it's been really, again, enlightening, really a really big confidence booster of me getting very, very clear about this process. And, you know, one thing I will say is right now I'm working on really creating this offer for individual clients right now. So one-on-one clients where, you know, we work together in a way that allows for me to provide my highest service and for them to get that ultimate transformation and outcomes that they're looking for. So rather than just doing one-on-one or one session to one session to one session, one session, et cetera, it's going to be more about, you know, creating or packaging my work so they get some video trainings, they get some worksheets, they get the one-on-one sessions with me, and then even some virtual, you know, what I call like accountability coaching, basically. So putting that all together in a way that really leads to that bigger ultimate transformation for the rest of their life.
Now, for some of the people that you've encountered through Drexel, have you met anybody who didn't really need that much of help to the point where it was just like overnight, like, I'm just going to quit doing this. And they focus on that inherently, almost like unbelievably. It's like, wow, you made this change overnight. It's kind of like some people can quit smoking just like on a drop of a hat. For whatever reason, have you ever encountered people like that?
Definitely a few, not many, because typically we have close to 500 athletes, so I don't work with every single one. Mm-hmm. That's for sure. Just in general, however, the ones that tend to work with me on an individual level are the ones that want to go deeper, and they do feel they want more support as they do it. So it's not often, or it's not always that, you know, that they couldn't do it on their own, because many of them could. However, they want that support, and it's about that connection that we have, which is really wonderful. So I have encountered a couple that come in once, and we have a great conversation. We maybe go over a couple tools, a couple skills. And they're able to apply it, and there they go. Awesome. Love it. But I would say, again, more often than not, it's more of the consistent schedule where we're just diving a little bit deeper each time and applying those skills on a consistent level.
Do you have a style to your guidance? Is there such thing almost like swimming, like to where it's different disciplines of swimming, almost to where it's different disciplines of cycling? Is there like a sort kind of style that you figured out through yourself as far as your guidance is concerned?
Yeah, that's really interesting, actually. So I think when I first started, I was not super confident yet because I hadn't had the experience.
Sure.
So when I first started, I think I was sticking more to, textbook stuff, right?
Really, I understand, yeah.
Yeah, it's really coming from what I read in the textbooks, the precise way that they applied some of these skills. And that actually, I think, made me more anxious. So that's probably part of why I was getting those tension headaches. Because I was doing things in a way that, granted, I learned,
right,
but it wasn't super aligned with me and what my style was meant to be. So this past year, I think because I've gotten the experience, I've learned a lot of lessons, and I've also done a lot of personal work. I do my own, go to my own therapist. I've started a meditation practice the last year and a half or so. And I go listen to more music. Yeah. I go out more. I connect with more people. Yeah. So doing all of these things has allowed me to get more grounded and be more present in my conversations with people. And by doing that, I'm able to really connect. So I would say connection is a massive part of my style. Whereas when I was trying to just do things textbook, it was surface level. You're not connecting as much in that way. So by connecting with them and, developing that working relationship in a deeper, more meaningful way, I've been better able to assess what they need in that moment. And for some, it's just to talk it out, to get it out of their brain, dump it out on the table, basically. For others, it is a little bit more structured. And maybe it is we go right to this skill. We go right to this strategy and applying it. So that's being more present and connecting, I would say, are the two biggest parts of my style.
Speaking of connecting, who are you connecting with now on a music level? What are you listening to now?
Oh my goodness.
Who are you listening to now?
Gosh, I listen to so much. I listen to so many different genres and so many different artists. And it really depends on the day or the moment in the day what I'm going to be listening to. So you mentioned Don Diablo. I do love a good future house situation. So Don Diablo is really wonderful. I still do go back to Daft Punk often. It's always
in my playlist.
Is Daft Punk
going to come back? Are they going to come back?
I would die. Let me just say
everybody
that.
Would.
I would actually die, and I will go anywhere on this planet to see them. You can hold me to that.
Sure.
Please do. So, and did you see how serious I just got? It was a really serious thing.
You were
thing.
Just almost as serious as Alex Miles going to Eric Pritz concert for like the millionth time.
That's exactly it. Because if they had a bunch of shows, they may never do that again. So
right.
You best
of
believe
course,
I need to
course.
Go to as many as possible. Whew. So that's a big one. That's truly, truly, truly big for me. And there's just a couple, let's see. I love Alesso. He's one of my favorites. It's just pretty.
Sexy guy.
Yeah, he is. Sorry,
Eric. Along with Nicky Romero.
He's
got that like baby kind of face, but like
does.
Stern,
he's,
I don't know.
It's like a Dutch. He's
yeah,
Dutch.
Very,
it's a
yes,
Dutch
yes,
thing.
Yes, yeah. It's very much a Dutch thing.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, so some of those are, are my style, but I've really been getting more into a little bit more of like trancey, progressive trance type of stuff, which is interesting. And we're going to throw it out there for Ashley and Carlos. I like techno now.
Sure.
Oh my gosh. Now it's funny because when I first started listening to like Daft Punk and things like that, for example, I didn't know what I was talking about. I thought everything was techno. I genuinely just thought it was all techno. I had no idea. I was 15 years old. And now I know a little bit more. But the thing about the reason why I've, you know, grown to really like techno is because it's the music that's always playing when I'm now with my friends. And I love that. So it's going full circle back to that connection of it's what my friends play. It's what they listen to. And I love that.
Yeah.
It's very cool.
I think you can hear the sirens through the microphones. I'm sorry if you hear that background noise. It's Philly. Something's going on. There's always something going on.
There's
to the point where you can't really catch
something.
Up. Okay. So I got my tickets for Movement Detroit.
Oh, nice.
Well, cool. I didn't get them. I just purchased them. They have yet to arrive in the mail.
Cool.
But that's going to be in May. I'm like really forward. I'm looking really very much to that.
Awesome. I'll be at Elements that weekend on this side.
Right. Okay. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Gotcha. But anyway, that's in New York? Where is that at?
It's in Lakewood, Pennsylvania. Okay, so Lakewood. It's close to New York. But excited for that. My first camping festival. Yep. So
I'm listening to more of Regal.
Okay.
Regal is this techno artist that just so happened to come up during Time Warp.
Mm.
Like Brian Feldman knew who he was, knew who Brian Brian Feldman knew who Regal was, aka Felsey. He knew who he was. I think everybody in the room, like this was before we went out to Time Warp day two or day one, and everybody was gathering, everybody was like pre-gaming, and it was like, you know who Regal is? And like, he didn't question me that, but I was just like, that was like, who is Regal? If Brian knows about Regal, I should know about Regal. And it turns out he plays like this old school kind of techno.
Cool.
I'm getting much more into that because what I'm feel as far as techno is concerned now, like people are just bumping up the BPM to a point where it's like very like brittle,
which is kind of
bad thing. Like we're getting like too enthralled into the music to where it's like becoming super hard.
Yeah.
To a point where it's coming like brittle. And it's like,
what BPM
you
would you say that's
down?
At? Because that's something like, I'm starting to learn about.
Around like 140, 150.
Ooh. Oh my gosh. That's fast.
It's now 140 BPM techno. It's not nothing new.
Okay.
But it, as far as it being a sound here in Philadelphia, that's kind of, we're pushing the BPM limit to like 130 at least.
Okay.
Towards the end of our sets. And that's cool, but it's like when is it going to ever stop?
Sure.
And that's when I'm kind of like questioning that kind of sound.
Okay.
Because like, where do you go from there? And what I'm seeing some artists do is go into more of a trance also towards the end of their sets, to the point where it's like alleviating so much of the bass and like kind of texture of that and being a little bit more soft yet fast. And I think that's good.
Yeah.
It's something I want to attain to. It's something I'm interested in. But I don't listen to too much trance. I should get more into that.
Mm-hmm. I'm going to see Paul Van Dyke in 2 weeks. So he's like a trance legend.
Did you see Paul Oakenfold?
No.
By chance when he was in AC?
But he is also basically a legend, I
would
say,
yes,
right?
Yes, he's been doing it for a long time.
Yeah, I saw a couple minutes, maybe only 10 minutes of Paul Van Dyke's set when I was in England for Creamfields Music Festival this past summer. And when we left, because I think we might have left because we had to go get in the massive group of people waiting to see Swedish House Mafia, which is why.
Did you see them?
Yes, I did.
Don't you worry, child.
That's why I flew to England, let me tell you. So I'm not afraid to fly somewhere for a certain DJ. But when I left Paul Van Dyke's set, you know, I remember saying, I need to see this guy. Right. I really want to see this guy again. So, and he's trance. So I'm looking forward to that.
Awesome.
Yeah.
I'm getting a low battery light on the recorder. So before, I'm just going
to
kind of.
Sounds like me. I tend to get
I do have an extra set of batteries. But do you have any shots, promotions? Do you want to put out there?
You know, for the moment, still going to keep that close to the chest. However, you know, I can shout out like my website and stuff.
Sure,
can we go with that?
Sure. Yeah.
So yeah, you can find me at my website, madelinembarlow.com. And that's for my personal business, but also I have, you know, the same name for my Instagram and for my Facebook. Go to Instagram first though. It's really cool. It's a fun place to be.
All the hip kids are doing it.
Exactly. Well, I'm telling you, that's where my soul clients are. They're on Instagram. But I also, you know, on my Instagram, I do post some interesting things about, you know, my experiences with music, my experience learning how to shuffle recently. Super awesome. Love it. And that really, you know, applies well to the work that I do with athletes and former athletes too.
I can't shuffle. I could two-step though. Yeah, but it's like
I taught myself. My way there. I never thought I could, but look at that. It is mindset. I'm telling you. Like, here we go.
Last question. How did you meet Ryan Lochte?
Oh goodness. How did I meet Ryan Lochte? I met him at a swim meet, just in the same place I met Michael Phelps and Natalie Coughlin and all of the people that I look up to or did look up to when I was younger. So I really, you know, it was the first time I went up to someone on my own and said, I want to meet this person because I really appreciate what he's doing and I loved it. So, I was so nervous, but how cool. And he was extremely nice. He was just an extremely nice person.
So kick ass. We'll leave it on that note.
Yeah.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is episode 16 of Xclude with Xclude. Thank you for joining me.
Thank you for having me.
You could see this on, you can't see this, but you can hear us on SoundCloud. I'm being lazy on YouTube. I really have to update that shit. But most of my viewers are, at least my listeners are on SoundCloud anyway. You can find me on SoundCloud. You can see me on Instagram. You can find me on Facebook just as well. Until next time, cheers, y'all. Peace.
Bye.
That's
so fun.
Yeah.